Finally, we're going to just do a few extra in-depth ideas about some of these different brain areas. A little extra dimensionality to what we just told as the overall story. So this is a way of thinking about how the different brain areas sort out in terms of the kinds of learning that operate in these brain areas. And so here we have these kind of core primitive brain areas that are present in most animals, the basal ganglia and the cerebellum. And they kind of neatly sort of organize according to these learning principles. The basal ganglia fundamentally learns about reward, reinforcement, everything that we're going to see about behaviorism and classical conditioning and instrumental conditioning, learning to do things that lead to reward and avoiding things that lead to punishment is all what the basal ganglia does. And it uses this dopamine reward signal to do that. In contrast, the cerebellum is all about kind of error signals. And so when you trip or you move and you try to grab your cup and you spill the coffee, those are all examples of kind of errors. Anytime you have a disfluent motor action, that's another more subtle kind of error signal. And the cerebellum is very sensitive to that and learns to correct those kinds of inefficient, non-fluid motions. So these are really the most important things you need to survive. You need to do things that lead to reward, and you need to be able to do actions that are efficient and effective and don't cause you to fall over and trip and, do all sorts of clumsy stuff. On top of that, you have these more advanced kinds of brain systems that appear later in evolution, and they involve multiple levels of these different kinds of learning signals. And that's what we're meaning by these little plus signs here. So like the hippocampus has some element of reward-based learning. It has some element of error-driven learning, but it also has this new kind of learning, which is we call self-organizing learning. Perhaps a better term there is more like automatic learning. It can learn all the time, regardless of whether there's an error or reward or not. It's just kind of constantly learning, and that's encoding these events of your life. Okay. And so even though we are more likely to remember highly rewarding or highly error-driven kind of, surprising aspects of our lives, we still also have the boring stuff in there to some extent. And so the hippocampus is always encoding. The neocortex is really this kind of much more balanced type of learning. It has definitely a strong component of reward and error-driven learning and also self-organizing learning. It kind of has all these different types of learning. And so it really is a much more kind of powerful, flexible form of learning that integrates all these different signals. So this gives you a sense of, kind of covering the basics in these core brain areas and then kind of going beyond and doing more powerful, flexible things in these higher level brain areas. This is a diagram of the hippocampus showing how it really builds on top of the cortical hierarchy. You see the ventral stream in the infratemporal cortex, the parietal dorsal stream that we talked about. Those feed up in the medial temporal lobe into the parahippocampal cortex and the perirhinal cortex. And then from there into this thing called the entorhinal cortex. Rhinal here refers to the kind of nose olfactory system. And these brain areas are right next door to where the primary olfactory information comes in the rhinal cortex. So that's where they get their name, but they're not just about odor perception, they're all of memory. But it does sort of explain why olfaction does have a special access to our memory systems. And so then, what the key point here, though, is that the entorhinal cortex has this extremely compressed, very high-level picture of everything that's going on in the cortex as a result of seeing this kind of compact stream of information coming in. And it's able to take this kind of snapshot that encodes kind of the entire state of what's happening out there in the world as filtered through these highly compressed representations in the cortex. And so memory operates on a very compressed representation. And so our memories are fundamentally very vague. They're very abstract. They're very high level. They're very efficient. And the reason we can have so many memories is because they are encoding things at such a high abstract level. That's what makes them efficient. And then we can see here these different areas of the hippocampus proper that do important aspects of encoding that we'll talk about later. Here's a picture of the basal ganglia showing you how the different pathways that I referred to, this fundamental decision-making choice of am I going to do it or am I not going to do it, this go versus no-go choice, is modulated by these dopamine neuromodulatory signals here coming in and helping train up the history of experience. Was it a good idea to do what I just did or not? And that's what dopamine tells us, is was it a good idea or not? And then that builds up these associations over time with these different ideas that frontal cortex is providing. Again, the idea that frontal cortex is this kind of big picture idea generator, coming up with the possible plans. And then the striatum is this kind of hard-nosed decision maker, sort of like, this was not a good idea last time, and we are not going to do that again because, you know, we didn't feel good after we had that cake. And I wish my basal ganglia would do that for me. But that is kind of the general division of labor, deciding what is really worth it or not worth it out of the big space of ideas that the frontal cortex is coming up with. In the cerebellum, there's a very, very elaborate, complicated circuitry in the cerebellum. It's a really amazing brain system. These cells called the Purkinje cells are some of the most unique, amazing, you know, complicated cells in the brain. They have 100,000 different inputs as opposed to like 10,000 different inputs. So very, very high dimensional information that's getting processed there. And that's part of what allows them to kind of memorize the correct action to take in different situations based on this very high level representation. And there's a way of understanding what the cerebellum is doing in terms of these abstract computational ideas developed for the something called the support vector machine, which is a very popular idea in computer science just prior to the new deep neural networks that kind of took over as the newest fad. And so David Marr and Alvis basically came up with these ideas a long time ago, and they really have stood the test of time in terms of understanding how the cerebellum works and uses these error signals to improve our motor control. Language is something that integrates so many different brain areas, and so it makes it a very interesting topic for understanding how these different brain areas work together. This is kind of a little diagram showing you that you have these kind of core elements of kind of how words are written, how words are pronounced, but really they're fundamentally distributed and integrating knowledge across the entire brain in terms of action words and words that tap into our somatosensory, kind of how things feel, words that tap into visual information, how things look. And so it really is distributed across the whole brain, as well as involving kind of more specialized areas specific to language. And then the frontal cortex, again, so critical for control. We see this again and again, that we need this capacity for control. It plays this fundamental organizing principle of organizing our behavior towards overall goals, outcomes that we want. And so the kind of boss of your brain lives up there in frontal cortex, the central executive, and it provides this kind of top-down control signal telling the rest of your brain, hey, here's what you got to be thinking about. Don't be distracted. Don't lose focus. This is what matters to us right now. And as we said before, we'll see in the next chapter how when we go to sleep, this frontal cortex kind of turns off specifically, and then you get all this kind of crazy coming out. And finally, we can understand more about the fine-grained organization of frontal cortex in terms of different subregions. This is kind of a splaying out of the medial wall of the frontal cortex down into the lateral surface. So understanding how different parts of frontal cortex are organized with respect to the more medial and ventral areas that encode affective and motivational signals. So there's this very important part of the brain called the anterior cingulate cortex, ACC, and that's just underneath kind of the outer layer of the frontal cortex, and it seems to have kind of coordinated encoding of the kind of affective and value information associated with the different possible action plans that you might be contemplating in the dorsal prefrontal cortex. And then also there's evidence of kind of value encoding for different possible outcomes in what we call the orbital frontal cortex, this area just right above the orbits of the eyes. That encodes kind of what you want. And so this is kind of like, how are you going to get it and what you want? And between those two things, you're in pretty good shape for encoding kind of the different motivational variables for driving behavior in the right way. And this area right here, this red area, is particularly interesting. A scientist named Helen Mayberg has really focused on understanding the role of this area 25 in encoding negative affective states. It seems to be very important for major depressive disorder. And when we think so much about, you know, all these media interpretations of people as being sort of what makes us human is our emotional life and the richness of our emotional lives. Actually, a lot of those emotions kind of can be traced down into the brainstem in brain areas that we actually share with many other animals. But this part of that whole system is really kind of uniquely special to at least primates and especially humans in terms of this kind of very high dimensional rich encoding of all these different dimensions of our emotional life as we use that to guide our behavior. So when we think about control, this is kind of the hot button, hot seat aspect of control, driving what we engage our control for.